Hello friends, I am CA Divya Bansal and today I am here with another video. In this video, we will be dealing about export procedures in GST. Before moving on to the export procedures, let us understand the meaning of some basic terms of export. Now, export can be done in two ways. Either it can be export of goods or export of services. As per Section 2 of IGST Act, export of goods mean taking goods out of India to a place outside India. And for export of services, we have to fulfill some conditions, which are: first, the supplier needs to be located in India, that is, supplier of service must be located in India. Second, the recipient of service must be located outside India. Third, the place of supply must be outside India. Fourth, the payment must be received in convertible foreign exchange. And fifth, that they should not be merely distinct persons. After this, let us understand the meaning of zero-rated supplies. Zero-rated supplies, as per Section 16 of IGST Act, means supplies made to the SEZ unit or the SEZ developer and the export of goods and services. Now, one major question comes up: are zero-rated supplies and exempt supplies same? No, my dear friends, they are totally different terms. Zero-rated supplies are defined in Section 16 of IGST Act, which includes the export of goods and services and the supplies made to the SEZ unit and developers. In this, you can claim the input tax credit of the taxes paid. But in case of exempt supplies, they are defined in Section 2 of CGST Act and you cannot claim the refund of the taxes paid on the input. Moreover, they include the goods or services which attracts nil rate of duty or are wholly exempt from taxes as per the exemption list issued by the government. So both these two terms are different and should not be mixed with each other. After this, let us understand what are the possible ways of export. Export can either be made on payment of taxes, that is IGST, since it is an interstate supply as per the IGST Act, or it can be done without payment of taxes. First of all, let us understand the payment of taxes method in case of export. You need to pay IGST just like the usual domestic trade. Once you have paid the same, furnish the valid return GSTR-3 for the particular tax period. Once it is being done, it shall be considered as deemed application for refund, provided that the person in charge of the conveyance has filed the EGM, that is Export General Manifest, or the Export Report before GSTR-3. Then 90% of the tax paid can be claimed as the refund within 7 days in form GST RFD 04, and remaining 10% will be given to you after proper scrutiny of the exports by the tax authority in next 60 days. Now the question comes, what is Export General Manifest or the Export Report? Now, the PIC of the conveyance, for example, pilot in case of aircraft, driver in case you are exporting via road, etc. Before the departure of the conveyance from the custom station in case of aircraft or vessel, files the Export General Manifest, or in case of vehicle, files the Export Report containing the details of the goods taken by them from the Indian frontier to the other country. So the time PIC files this EGM or the export report, the exporter shall be eligible to claim the refund as per the prescribed procedure. In case you are exporting with payment of taxes, make sure that in your invoice you must write supply meant for export on payment of IGST. This is part of the compliance procedure in GST law. Now the next is exporting without payment of taxes. In case you are exporting without payment of taxes, then you have two methods available. First is on furnishing LUT, that is letter of undertaking, and second is on furnishing of the bond. First of all, we will be understanding the LUT method, that is a letter of undertaking method. The question comes, who are eligible to furnish the LUT? All those who are status holder as per paragraph 5 of Foreign Trade Policy 2015-20 are eligible to furnish the LUT, or the ones who have received the foreign inward remittances amounting to minimum 10% of the export turnover or rupees 1 crore, whichever is higher, provided that he has not been prosecuted for any offence under CGST Act or the existing laws in case where the amount of tax evaded exceeds rupees 2.5 crores. Also, the validity of letter of undertaking is 12 months. That is, once the 12 months are completed, you need to furnish the fresh LUT for the exports. Now, what is the meaning of status holder? Status holders are those business leaders who have excelled in international trade, and this is sort of a privilege given by the government to the exporter. Now, the status categories are defined on the basis of the export performance done by the status holder. Like, they can be either 1-star export house, 2-star export house, and likewise. If you fall in any of these status categories, then you can definitely opt for the LUT method and can export your goods or services accordingly. For furnishing the LUT, you must furnish form RFD 11 in your letterhead if you are doing it manually. Next, it shall be executed by the working partner or the managing director or the person duly authorized on the letterhead of the registered person. If the exporter fails to comply with the conditions of LUT, then the PO may ask you to furnish the bond in respect of the exports made by you. Again, one of the invoicing requirements comes up in case you are exporting using LUT. Do mention that supply meant for export under LUT without payment of IGST. Moving on to second method in without payment of GST, it is making exports under bond. In bond, those persons who are not eligible for the LUT are required to furnish the bond on non-judicial stamp paper of the amount of tax liability on that particular export, along with the bank guarantee, which in any case will not be more than 15% of the bond amount. Now, let us understand the same with an example. Suppose an exporter wants to export the goods worth rupees 1 crores having 18% tax rate applicable on that particular item, then the bond amount shall be 18% of 1 crores, that is 18 lakh, and the bank guarantee amount shall be maximum of 15% of the bond value, that is 15% of 18 lakhs, 2.7 lakhs. Now, in case of export, we can have two types of bonds. First is one-time bond and second is the running bond. In case you are not making exports frequently, then you can opt for one-time bond, which will be valid only for one shipping bill. But in case you are a frequent exporter, then you should opt for running bond because you can export without worrying about the compliance procedure of bond again and again till the time bond limit is exhausted. Again, there is an invoicing requirement in case of bonds. You must mention supply meant for export under bond without payment of IGST. Now, as we have understood that export can be made either with the payment of taxes or without payment of taxes in case of bond and LUT, there are some documents which must be submitted to the PO in case of furnishing the bond and LUT. Here is a checklist for the same. First of all, you must give the request letter on the letterhead of the company for acceptance of the documents. Second is form GST RFD 11 on your letterhead if you are doing it manually. Third is the LUT or the bond as specified in rule number 96A of CGST rules. Then comes the bank guarantee in case of the bond, which needs to be furnished. Then the certificate of status holder if you are one of them. The constitution certificate, GST registration certificate, copies of return DVAT 16 for all the four quarters of financial year 16 and 17. export bill invoice for former invoice, CA certificate with last year export and sales figures. Next is certificate of bank on realization of foreign inward remittance and the other KYC documents. And in case you are not going yourself and you are sending some other person on your behalf, then the authority letter for the same. You must take all these documents in two copies, that is, one will be kept with the PO and on other set you will be getting the receiving. Next is the process of refund. The time you have paid the IGST, or in case of bond or LUT, when you want to claim the refund of the taxes paid, then the following procedure shall be adopted. As in, when the exporter files GSTR1 on the portal, the details of shipping bills and the GST invoice will be mentioned in the same. The same shall be transmitted electronically to the custom system, and the said system, after verification, will confirm to the GST portal that such goods as covered in the invoice, they are actually exported out of India. Once it is done, the exporter shall file GSTR3, which shall be a confirmation for the same that the goods have been exported, and same shall be sent to the custom system. Once satisfied, custom system shall process the refund and credit the amount to the bank account of the exporter. Let us deal with some other miscellaneous provision in relation to exports. In case you do not comply, what will be the liability in case you do not comply with the provisions as per GST law? In case of goods, if the goods are not exported within 3 months of the date of invoice, and in case of services, if the foreign exchange is not received within 1 year from the date of invoice, then in next 15 days, you must pay the tax along with the interest as mentioned in Section 50 of the GST Act. The maximum time to claim refund of the taxes paid on the inputs or the output is 2 years from the relevant date. The next question comes up, what is the relevant date? Relevant date is different in case of export of goods and export of services. In case of export of goods, if you are exporting by sea or air, the date on which ship or aircraft leaves India. By land, it will be the date on which goods cross the frontier, and by post, it will be date of dispatch of goods by post office. In case of export of services, the relevant date will be if the supply is completed before receipt of payment, then it shall be date of receipt of foreign currency. And in case payment is being received before date of invoice, then the relevant date shall be the date of issue of invoice. Now, if you are making both the taxable supplies within India and you are exporting also, then what should be the amount of refund? To calculate the refund amount, we will refer the CGST rules, which says that refund amount shall be equivalent to sum total of turnover of zero rated supplies of goods and services multiplied with the net input tax credit divided by adjusted total turnover. Let us understand these three terms. Turnover of zero rated supply of goods or services includes the aggregate payment received during the relevant period for which services have been completed. Subtract from it the advances received during the relevant period for which services have not been completed. For the net ITC, it means input tax credit availed on input and input services during the particular tax period, and adjusted total turnover means all the taxable supplies, all the export supplies, interstate supplies, but it excludes the value of exempt supplies while computing the same. So friends, I hope that I am able to clarify you in regard to the export procedure in GST. Please do subscribe my channel Tax Without Tears and like my Facebook page for regular updates on GST. Thank you.